Good morning to you all. At the outset, I would like to thank all the organizers for giving me this opportunity. It's a very unique opportunity for me. I have talked in front of several colleagues of mine who are scientists like me, but this is the first time I have really been standing in front of people who directly don't belong to my discipline. So I come from a research institute called Jawaharlal Nehru Research Center, which is right in the city of Bangalore. I may be considered as an expert in HIV pathogenesis, molecular biology, and immunology. And I had a very unique opportunity, which is very unique, to test one of these polyherbal medicines to see whether this can have some protective functions against HIV/AIDS. So today's talk is essentially about this, how we got into it, how we actually conduct this trial in city of Bangalore in human clinical infected subjects, and what kind of results we got and what is the kind of inference are going to come out using this data what we generated. We all know that HIV has no vaccine and there is not even a hope for a vaccine for the next 10 to 15 years of time. We have very high quality medicines, but they have their own problems, which is technically known as antiretroviral therapy. In this backdrop, people have attempted several other strategies. One of them is immunotherapy. For instance, people use several potent cytokines like IL-2, interferon gamma, many others. But the problem that we faced with HIV is very exceptional, in that when you are trying to strengthen the immune system, it's a catch-22 situation. As you are strengthening the T cell, you are also strengthening the virus, because virus feeds on the very immune system. So that is where many of these research strategies haven't really gone anywhere, either in vaccine development or medicines or immunotherapies or various combinations thereafter. So this is what essentially you see in HIV. What is shown here is, okay, can you see, is it what? Sorry? Oh, it's not. Okay, great. So what you're seeing here is, as a function of time, when the virus enters the cell or the system, there is a very large amount of virus in the initial phases of the infection, let's say up to 3 months of time. Virus is controlled to a great extent by the immune system itself, which is called asymptomatic, which lasts a few years. Then again, virus again flares up, which you call AIDS. Now, if you superpose a CD4 cell on which the virus feeds, the cell gradually declines continuously and gradually. When this number falls something like around 200 cells, that is when AIDS starts. So the problem here is the depletion of CD4 cell by the viral infection. So when we are conducting a clinical trial, people want to look at these two parameters to understand where they are on the infection status. For instance, if the treatment is functioning, it should improve the quality or number of CD4 cells, or it should control viral load, or both. So this is antiretroviral therapy. So when you use antiretroviral therapy, the virus is immediately controlled and below detection limit as long as you continue using this medicine. But despite its many various advantages, this medication should be taken lifelong. This is the biggest problem. So compliance becomes a very serious matter, in addition to expenses and toxicity. For this reason, complement alternative medicines have been a very popular option all over the world, including in India. But there haven't been many trials to test whether these really do a helping hand to the people who are actually taking this complement alternative medicine. I don't want to explain the merits of or the qualities of alternative medicine to this audience. There have been several in India that are very unique for India, like Siddha, Ayurveda, Yunani. But we don't have any clinical trials to really test the claims these disciplines make that they can really help the people. So this is the biggest advantage we probably conceive with alternative medicine. Unlike heart, we should be taken lifelong. Siddha is taken, or any alternative medicine taken, for a few months without further administration. The claim is that this medicine administration helps people in reducing virus. So this was very big interest to me, because at that point of time, I was looking for something called selective immunomodulator. Many of us who have taken chemistry in class school would have realized that something called noble gas never existed. But still we know what are the properties of this noble gas. Similarly, I was on the hunt for something called selective immunomodulator. What do I mean by this? You cannot strengthen the immune system, which in turn strengthens the virus. So I call a selective immunomodulator that which strengthens the immune system but not the virus. Whether that exists or not is the question of this clinical trial. So this is an open label, non-randomized, controlled, single site, small scale, investigator blinded, human clinical trial. I know there are several problems with this definition. Non-randomization is not a very good thing to do, but there are several reasons why you have to get into non-randomization. In non-randomization, especially in open label trial, non-randomization is permitted technically, though it is not desirable. We use 63 participants, 32 under this polyherbal medication, and 31 under HART, the standard antiretroviral therapy. And this was registered with the ICMR clinical trial registry. The primary endpoints are monitoring CD4 count and viral load. Second endpoints are much more important for me as a scientist, which is clinical symptoms. As I'm going to show eventually, the inclusion criteria are the people who have CD4 count around 200 and 250. Why is that so important? That is the one which gives the opportunity to check in case if this immunomodulation is not really helpful, there should be 8 clinical manifestation developing. That should be helpful, more important than these primary endpoints, because primary endpoints are only surrogate markers. What does that mean? They only indicate, but never can with precision tell you where the patient is and what is the treatment efficacy is. So the most important thing for us is second endpoints. If the treatment is not good, there should be a big difference between these two. And I'm going to skip several slides. I'm going to show several slides to tell you what kind of precautions we have taken to ensure human rights and many other aspects of this clinical trial. We screened a very large number of people, identified potential volunteers, and we subjected them to several rounds of counseling before they are taken into this study. And they were recruited in several batches, and this recruitment took nearly 1 year. This is the drug regimen used for HART. I will not get into the description because I don't have much time. And this is the drug regimen for Siddha medication, which is administered only for 4 months at the inception without any additional administration thereafter. The biggest problem always you encounter when you are talking about alternate medicines is the quality. Every physician has his own concoction, and we do not know how many ingredients are gone into it or what is the quality of these ingredients. To avoid this problem, we used a single lot of medication, which is used for drug toxicity tests as well as laboratory experiments and as well as clinical trial. And Professor Dubey, who is sitting in the, among the audience, he has done extensive pharmacological characterization of these formulations eventually. And we did subject this same lot for toxicity tests. A third party did this, and there have been several tests done, and the summary is that it is non-toxic. And our own clinical trial has a component where the blood at every bleed has been subjected to various rounds of toxicity tests. And the summary is that it is absolutely safe for human administration. These are inclusion criteria. I already told you CD4 cells, 200 to 250. That is where we taken them. Subjects are drug naive. That is very critical. And they are free from any AIDS-related symptoms. Exclusion criteria, there are many here. There is a problem here, but I will not get into it. Informed consent form, incentives, no financial incentives, but they're all costs are borne, including the medication, incidental costs, and many others have been taken. The most important thing is the last one. These people who are under heart therapy have been transferred to government-sponsored programs at the end of the clinical trial. So there are no violation of human rights here. We followed all ethics and good laboratory practices, confidential maintenance, etc., etc. We did not monitor, but the NGO has been recruited. Their IEC monitored this clinical trial progress throughout. We even had a midterm safety evaluation. And I will tell you why I showed this slide is for simple reason. Okay, I will come to the next slide. We started this trial in 2004, permission obtained in 2004, but not for the next 3 years we could initiate because this committee really has done its job. It took nearly 2 years to convince the ethics committee that we can do this job without violating their participants' rights. Logistics, samples collected every 3 months, and they were transported to my laboratory at JNCSR. I told you this is an open label trial. The patients, the participants, clinicians, counselors knew what the participants were taking, But my lab in JNCSR did not know which blood coming from this under code belongs to which of these two categories. So we are blinded to this trial until the unblinding was done, the study ended. And people associated, I've been the co-investigator, and Dr. Satish, he's the PI of clinical. The entire thing was conducted under his supervision. And the most important thing is student investigator, especially Mangyar Karasi, he's sitting among the audience. Without her, this trial couldn't have been possible. And there are several allopathic clinicians in addition to Dr. Satish, Siddha clinicians. There are seven of them. One every week came from Shastra University to be at the clinic to counsel these people. Trained counselors, statisticians, NGO, and its ethics committee, and polyherbal formulation formulated by Dr. Arun, Vedic Remedies, and funds by three different organizations, one DST, JNCSR, my own institute, and the company fund channel through DST. This is the progress of the committee. I will summarize this in the next slide. So this summarizes the whole recruitment process of this trial and its progress. As I said, we screened all of these people. People have been recruited and they have been divided between two different groups, Siddha as well as Heart. And at the end of first year, we did midterm evaluation. We found a problem right there. The committee identified that in some of these people, the CD4 cell dropped below 200 cells. This created a trouble for us. It becomes an ethical question now. I was really worried that the committee would stop the clinical trial. But what they did instead was they asked us to take this information to all the participants and give the choice to them, whether to continue or to discontinue. We did that, and some of these people decided to move to Heart. So we have created a new arm right here, pure Heart, pure Siddha, and those Siddha people who moved to Heart. We did not know at this point of time who are moved to which group. We are still blinded. And this study ended at this time, unblinding was at this time, and there are one death in all these 2 years and plus one observation year, 3 years, two deaths in the Heart group and a single death in Siddha group. And I'm going to describe this in little greater detail. Though it is an open label trial, no, it is not randomized. We are taking care of balancing several of these important parameters like age, gender, education status, employment, many things we matched. Most of these things, these two groups matched equally. The most important thing is CD4 count between these two groups is equally identical. We used FDA-approved technologies. The viral load was done using this EquiSense, their own machine, their own cleat, and we did CD4 count using BD reagents. All of them are FDA-approved, and trained PhD students doing these jobs. This is what we did. This Heart, this is the administration. Every 3 months blood is collected, and Siddha given for only 4 months, and blood collected identically, samples sent to my laboratory for these tests. The most important thing is that the bleeding actually happened for over a period of 24 months and 12 numbers. It's not 1, 2, or 3 points, but we have 12 or 10 time points across these 2 years. These are all the experimental strategies what we did. In addition to viral load and CD4 count, we did extensive blood chemistry at each time point, and we did record all the clinical symptoms. We did even thymus scanning at the entry, at the exit, because if there is a difference, thymus gives you important clues. We did HLA typing. I will explain why that is important. Viral subtyping and polychromatic flow cytometry and drug toxicity testing we did. And we did extensive statistics. That itself becomes a very important problem, the statistics itself, because that decides the outcome of your results and inference. And data from the clinical trial, it is important. It is only representative data. We haven't yet published these data, so they're still confidential. This is all the Heart people and the duration of their stay with us. Okay, all 30 of them. There are two deaths, as I said, at these two time points. Very few of these people manifesting AIDS-related clinical symptoms, but not many. This is Siddha participants, the duration they stayed with us. When they switched to Heart at the midterm safety evaluation, means this person and Siddha and thereafter under Heart. So this guy here creates the third group. This is the data. Please focus on the left-hand side first, Heart. What you see here is the following. The CD4 count, CD8 count, they are kinds of blood cells. CD4 is the one which is targeted for the virus and destroys, and CD8 is important for various reasons, and viral load. heart expected to bring down viral load significantly within a period of 3 to 6 months time. That is happening on all the people. And it stayed until the study period below detection limit as expected. Same thing happened to CD4. CD4 is expected to improve the CD4 count after heart initiation significantly, which has happened in our case, more or less in all the people. But look at the scatter in each of these. This is because of host variations. So this is serving as a very good standard for our clinical trial. Now comes the Siddha group. This is CD4 count. The CD4 is dropping in some of the people, and the mean, there is a group overall drop, but it is not really significant statistically. Same thing with CD8, no significant drop in CD8 cells or increase in CD8 cell. Most importantly, the viral load remains stable. The numbers are not really small, but these are not final statistics. We have done extensive analysis following this one. These are not the real data, which are consolidated eventually. As I said, there are only two deaths in group, which is expected. You don't expect much mortality. What is interesting is in Siddha group, I have only a single death. No other clinical manifestations are different between these two groups. And then we did HLA typing. If you are seeing an important difference, similarity or difference between these two groups, the most important factor that could influence is your MSC, your own host genetics. There should not be significant difference in this property between these two groups. We checked that one, neither in HLA class 1, A, B, C, or HLA class 2, no difference between these two groups. They don't differ from each other with respect to host genetics. So any difference what you are seeing cannot be ascribed to difference at the host genetic level. We did viral subtyping because viral subtypes could have different biological properties. And if people are more infected with one viral subtype than the other, some of the results could be ascribed to that. But all our analysis showed that they're all single subtypes, C, which is more dominant in India. So the summary at this point of time is heart group looks like it's behaving as it is expected to behave, increasing CD4, decreasing virus. Siddha group, no significant deterioration either in the viral load or in the CD4 count or the study period of 2 years and one period of observation. No toxic side effects in both the groups, what we are seeing. So the question we have right now at this point of time is this. Is the CD4 cell stabilized in the Siddha group? This is very important for me as a scientist. Why is that? I have enormous number of drugs to control the virus. What we do not have at this point of time is a selective immunomodulator. The virus, when it infects, the body knows how to protect itself. So what you need is to help the system to fight the virus. So now comes data interpretation. Again, this is only tentative because the work is still in progress. There are several limitations to this study, first of all, that is very important to understand. There is no placebo control for logistic reasons or ethical reasons. It is an open label trial, not a random blind study. That cannot eliminate the problem of placebo control, placebo effect on this study. No randomization, and the sample size is small, observation period is small. You understand the limitations of all these. Nature of the drug, again, this is non-confirmed, not FDA approved. So there are many, many problems here. Technically, another important problem is here. I told you CD4 count is only a surrogate marker. It cannot tell you the outcome of the, or cannot guess, predict the outcome of the study precisely. We do not know, this being the very first study from India, and that even in the world there are not studies after heart is introduced, we do not know what to expect when you start your study at 250 cells in the absence of medical intervention. Do you expect a rapid fall of the CD4 cell after 250 or a slower fall? If you look at the literature, I did not have time, I did not show all these slides to you. All possible models have been proposed by world literature. So there are several problems right here which not allow us to interpret this data. Now the question here is, what do we do from here? The only solution here is to conduct one more clinical trial, eliminating all these technical limitations what I've shown you. But that means enormous amount of commitment, funds, and resources. And is it really worth doing this? Or is there a partial solution? So this is where we people like scientists come into picture. Any trained scientist, clinician could have done what we have done until today, doing a clinical trial. What is important here is to give an explanation. If an apple is falling, you have to explain why that apple is falling. Observation alone is not sufficient. So we asked the question, is CD4 cell in the stabilized people different in its quality? That is the question we want to ask. The hypothesis is this. If the CD4 cell is stabilized, then that should be manifested in its own biological properties. For instance, this is a very important trial that appeared a few years ago from New England Journal of Medical Research. What did they do? They given IL-2, one important cytokine, to people. These people received only antiretroviral therapy. These people received antiretroviral therapy and IL-2. You see, there is very large number of CD4 cells immediately, but there is no difference between these two groups with respect to death or clinical manifestation. So it is not the number of CD4 cell, its quality is much more important. Now, how do you ask this question, is the CD4 quality is different or better? Sir. Sure. So we did look at several important parameters that tell us the property of the CD4 cell. I cannot get into it because I don't have time. Work is still progress, manuscript is in preparation. We certainly can give some directions how this future study should be made. This is my last slide. This is a very critical slide for me. Under no circumstances, the polyhybrid formulation evaluated in this present clinical trial must be considered a drug for HIV/AIDS. It can be referred to as a potential drug, but not a drug. Why is that? The experimental data are only indicative but not assertive of the beneficial effects. The beneficial effects must be confirmed in future clinical trials that are rigorous and uncompromising in the study design. This is my last study slide. No substitute for research-based evidence. I have seen several people arguing that we have strength of alternative medicine, but that must be proved experimentally. There is no substitute for this. CAM physicians of all disciplines must realize that rigorous clinical trials using modern technology is the only way to convince the world. With the wealth of thousands of years of inheritance to medical knowledge, Indian herbal formulations are a potential source for exploring and tapping selective immunomodulators. Thank you very much for your attention, and there are many people who contributed to this work, and I should highlight many, but I would at least highlight to one single person here, my own student Mangayar Karasi. Without her involvement, this study wouldn't have been possible. Thank you very much. Thank you.